When Harry was asked to talk about cancer epidemiology in the era of molecular genetics, I was a little concerned about what I was going to say. I am not an epidemiologist, so I'm just going through my thoughts as I went when I was asked to do this presentation. So I wonder, conventional epidemiology, as you all know, investigates the relationship between an exposure and a tumor in a population-based cohort. So the assumption is that this is a single homogeneous entity. But what happens in real life is that there are no tumors that are the same as the one to the another. And this is because each individual has a unique tumor, and this is the so-called theory of unique disease principle, in which the distinctive combinations of the omics and the type of cells and the interaction with the microenvironment make that tumor unique. So the molecular pathological epidemiology addresses the inherent heterogeneity of a single entity. And this is well exemplified by a single X disease in this image, in which we want to analyze a risk factor. And it is clear that if we have this category not subgrouped, it will be very difficult to highlight how much the risk factor influences the insurgence of one tumor. But if we subcategorize the tumor in subgroups according to molecular characteristics, for example, we will have much chances to identify a group in which molecular characteristics are responsible of a major response to a risk factor. And in the adult world, where the numbers are very high, for example, in colorectal cancer, these studies have demonstrated very important correlations. For example, in tumors which don't have WNT mutation, have higher risk to progress and also to develop in patients with obesity and low physical activity, while these factors do not influence tumors which have CTNBB mutation. But it is also true that some specific drugs can have a different influence. For example, the regular aspirin use may have a protective action for tumors in which there is a specific allele in WNT CTNB, and in this group it has a protective action. But in children, this is much more difficult because tumors are not so numerous. And we are lucky because a new approach is now working in all tumors, but it is especially important in pediatric tumors, where besides the classic histology and immunohistochemistry, the use of analysis of genome by NGS or whole genome sequencing, identifying recurrent genetic alterations and like chromosomal rearrangements or mutations, the epigenome, especially the DNA methylation, which highlights the tissue or the cell of origin of a tumor, and also the specific tumor, and also the transcriptome with the RNA-seq, which highlights the specific expression profile of a tumor. All these together have contributed to subclassification of tumors. And the current WHO classifications in the fifth edition are organized in in two main goals. The first goal is to give the possibility to formulate a diagnosis in the different countries of the world, independently from the access to the different technologies. So there is a basic approach, first level, in which, based on histology and immunohistochemistry, a diagnosis can be given. But there is also a second level, that is the more complex level, integrating genomic, epigenomic, and transcriptomic features, and complementing first and second level, we have the third level, that is the integrated diagnosis, which provides much more information in terms of molecular alterations in countries in which this approach is possible, thanks to the availability of technologies. So what we can say in pediatric tumors? As we know, pediatric tumors are rarities by definition, and the limitation of some epidemiological analysis are evident when we look at the estimates of numbers of pediatric tumors in children. The estimated cases in GloboScan is about 300,000 per year. But this estimate is probably an underestimate, because the ICD codes, which are the codes used all in the WHO to identify the specific histotype, sometimes may be wrong, sometimes are not collected, and there are countries in which tumors are not even diagnosed. In fact, in the 2015, World et al. Estimated the incidence of pediatric tumors in about 397,000 children per year. Another major issue is the heterogeneity of these tumors in children in terms of histotypes. And you can see how the histotypes vary according to year. And in the first years of life, the embryonal tumors, non-CNS, are more frequent, while in the later ages, in the adolescence, lymphomas are more frequent. So this variability is another problem that adds to the difficulty in stratification of risks in patients, in pediatric patients. And this is an overview of the major risk factors in children, which are represented by increasing of birth weight, by structural birth defects, and parental age at the birth, besides the environmental factors, which are less important, but not because are less important, but the reason is that there is a strong limitation in the data collection, which are done simply by questionnaires of use of proxies. Genetic factors play a major role in some tumors. We know that the estimate is that about 10% of pediatric tumors are related to tumor predisposition syndromes. But in my opinion, this is also an underestimate, and the extensive use of a molecular characterization of tumors will increase this percentage. And it is interesting also that genomic-wide association studies recently identified how common single nucleotide polymorphism may be associated to specific histotypes. But this study is also a limitation, because it's related to specific ethnicities. So more studies are needed. That said, we can say that pediatric tumors have unique characteristics related to their rarity, to the fact that cell of origin is mostly mesodermal, ectodermal, or we can say that these tumors are mostly developmental tumors. And while adult tumors are related to additional and cumulative effects of genetic alterations, in children there is one single genetic driver event, And the, there are only minor other genetic alterations, and most of the tumors arises as consequence of maturation block in a premature developing cell type. How the molecular subtyping can help to understand the risk in development of pediatric cancer, and especially the risk of environmental factor, and how these can influence the therapy and lead to a therapeutic approach. The new WHO classification is based on hybrid taxonomy. That means that our we identify tumors mostly recognized by, in the traditional way, the histogenetic approach based on morphological features. Then there are tumors which are identified on the exclusive basis of molecular features, and this is a new approach. And there are also tumors which are identified by both histology and molecular features. The upcoming WHO classification for pediatric tumors includes all these different chapters on the different organs. But it is a very interesting perspective because we can see in the different organs how there is a different progress in terms of knowledge of molecular characterization and its impact on the classification itself. And we can say that the most advanced one in this sense is the classification of pediatric CNS tumors. In fact, this classification, as you can see, those in green and in with a written new are all the entities which are characterized by a molecular alteration and are new entities. This classification includes a first distinction, that is adult CNS tumors, which are in the blue book in general on CNS tumors, and then in the pediatric book there are the pediatric type tumors, in which we distinguish the low and high grade gliomas, so pediatric low and high grade gliomas. And then there are a series of other tumors with different genetic alterations. And in particular, I will focus on the embryonal tumors of CNS. It is important to know that in the WHO classification, there are two levels, the essential criteria and the desirable criteria. The essential criteria are those that are required necessarily to define a diagnosis. For example, diffuse angiocentric glioma, we need to have the essential criteria. And then there are the desirable criteria that we can have or not. And in most of pediatric CNS tumors, among the essential criteria, the molecular features are required in terms of either NGS results, identification of recurrent translocations, or as methylation profiling analysis. In fact, in CNS, the methylation profiling is an especially relevant role in the categorization of tumors. This is the picture from the Heidelberg classifier that is a study carried on by the Heidelberg group, which they have analyzed thousands of brain tumors, and methylation profile is a powerful tool to differentiate all the histotypes. And methylation profiling has allowed in CNS to subgroup some entities, for example, in medulloblastoma or in the ependymomas. It's allowed also to discover novel entities, but it's also allowed the resolution of some historical entities like the pinnets. And I want to focus on these dissolved entities, the pinnet. Pinnet once were classified as central pinnet that were of central nervous system and the peripheral pinnet which were in soft tissue. And then there were pinnet also in the genitourinary tract. Pinnet in central nervous system that no more exist and they have been substituted by these entities you see here, in particular the embryonal tumor with multilayered rosette, the atypical teratoid tumor, the neuroblastoma with the FOXR2 activation, and high-grade neuropathic tumors with MN1 and BCOR alterations, while the EWS path rearranged neuroepithelial tumor are not yet in the CNS classification. And you can see also how molecular characteristics can help in creating subcategories. For example, in the multilayered rosette, we can see C19MC amplification and Dicer mutation, which identify two different subgroups. And also in atypical teratoid tumors, there are different molecular subgroups identified by methylation. This is the embryonal tumor with the multilayered rosette, and you can see the characteristic appearance of these tubular structures, which remember the primitive neuroectoderm. And it is interesting how in this category, there are morphological features which identify three morphological groups. The embryonal tumor with abundant neuropil and two rosettes, the ependymoblastoma and medulloepithelioma. But there are also, as I said before, two different molecular categories, the ones with the C19 amplification. Here you can see at FISH analysis. And then there is another category that is related to Dicer1 mutation and identifies patients with germline Dicer1 mutation. And you can see how identification of categories can expand knowledge and epidemiological studies from this example. This is a case we had 1 year ago. This is clearly a embryonal tumor with multilayered rosettes. This is LIN28, that is a marker of primitivity and primitivity of cells, and is typical of this tumor. But this tumor was not in the brain, but was in the ovary of an adolescent. And this tumor had also mutation and germline mutation of Dicer. So our knowledge started from CNS, right, also in the in visceral site, where probably a subset of ovarian pinnet represent one of the spectrum of Dicer1 syndrome. And moving to the peripheral pinnet, we can see that some entities, apart from the Ewing sarcoma, are the same or have same alteration as a subset of those in central nervous system, like BCOR sarcomas with BCOR alteration or cheek rearranged tumors. But it is interesting that while in central nervous system, this genetic alteration identify specific neuroepithelial tumor in the mesenchymal tissue, these are sarcomas with different morphology and different immunophenotype. And this is related to the fact that the same genetic alteration may lead to different types of tumors according to the cell of origin. So the cell of origin is important to drive the different phenotype of tumor. And you can also see how epidemiologically these tumors are different and once they were pulled all together. In fact, the Ewing has a peak of incidence in young people, right? Like the round cell sarcomas would have different fusion with this NFAP-C2 and EWS paths. You see the same translocation we saw previously in CNS. And then there are the BCOF sarcomas in which we can see two different layers. One is the BCOR with ITD, with internal tandem duplication, which are mostly typical of infants in soft tissue tumors, and BCOR fusions with BCOR CCNB3, mostly occurring in bone and in young adolescents. Cheek rearranged sarcomas, by contrast, are mostly visceral and or in the soft tissue and occur in adults, rarely in children. And as far as it concerns the classic Ewing sarcoma, I want to highlight a few things to show how the things are more and more complicated. Because the classic fusion of EWS-FLY1 can be derived by a simple balanced translocation or by the complex genetic events called chromoplexes or chromotripsis, which is the most frequent event driving the EWS ERG fusion or the other fusions. And when chromoplexes or chromotripsis are the event leading to the fusion, the tumors are more aggressive. Moreover, STAD2 mutations are also related when together with TP53 mutations are related to a more aggressive behavior. So we can see how even Ewing sarcoma is going to be not one disease, but a disease with subgroups in terms of pathogenetic mechanisms. And this is an example of an interesting case. This is a pelvic mass. This was once called PNET because it had these typical rosettes, but our tumor, apart from the classic CD99 positive staining, has BCOR immunopositivity. This is an example of how, from the molecular characterization, we can obtain some immunohistochemical surrogate markers that can help in the diagnosis simply using an immunohistochemical marker. And methylation profiling in this case revealed a score more than 0.9 that is very, very significant for a BCOR sarcoma, and NGS demonstrated a MAMMAL3 BCOR fusion. So this patient is an example of a sarcoma in pelvic region with BCOR MAMMAL fusion. And this is the methylation classifier for soft tissue sarcomas, and you can see how BCOR have their own isolated small group. But compared with methylation profiling used in CNS, in pediatric soft tissue tumor classification, the methylation profiling has not been included in the WHO classification. It has just been mentioned in the introduction, but it is not a tool in terms of diagnosis. And you can see in the classification of soft tissue tumors how the number of tumors which can carry specific genetic alteration is less than the tumors we see in central nervous system. And to close the part on sarcomas, I want to emphasize the history of a specific type of sarcomas, the rhabdomyosarcoma, that is one of the most frequent sarcomas in childhood, because this is a very good example of how molecular characterization is strictly related to epidemiological and prognostic categorization. Rhabdomyosarcoma is currently classified in embryonal, spindle sclerosing, alveolar, and pleomorphic, but pleomorphic is not typical of children. But if we, and these are, this is an example of an embryon, and this is the classic alveolar architecture of an alveolar rhabdomyosarcoma, and this is a spindle cell. But let's go back to the history, because this is very important to understand the present. In 1995, there was the ICR classification, which was a milestone in the classification of rhabdomyosarcomas, especially because it identified for the first time the spindle cell rhabdomyosarcoma called it leiomyomatous. But this is a completely different subtype compared to the one we call today spindle cell sclerosing. And another important point is the definition of alveolar rhabdomyosarcoma. In this classification, based on survival analysis, which gave for alveolar rhabdomyosarcomas, according to this definition I'm going to give you, a worse survival, they included also a rhabdomyosarcoma in which only a small focus of alveolar pattern was present, although the rest of the tumor was embryonal. They defined this as alveolar, and also solid variant of alveolar was introduced. But it is especially important, this definition of a small focus that led to a rise in the numbers of diagnosis of alveolar rhabdomyosarcoma in the protocols, either in Europe or in the United States. The advent of molecular characterization led to demonstrated that alveolar rhabdomyosarcomas, which are about 30%, 20% of them did not have the fusion of FOXO1 gene. That is an important characterizing element of alveolar rhabdomyosarcoma. And survival analysis demonstrated that alveolar rhabdomyosarcomas lacking the translocation had the same survival as embryonal, while survival was worse for patients with a fusion positive. Based on this, the current protocols stratify patients, this is the FAR-RMS protocol, based on presence or absence of fusion and no more on histology. But we have to consider that the stratification of the patients in the those survival analysis were carried based on a diagnosis of alveolar based on morphology. And we all know that one of the prognostic factors is also the treatment. And these studies from the UK analyzed how many patients would have been treated with a less aggressive treatment, basing the stratification on fusion, and the amount of patients was about a quarter of patients. So the upcoming protocol will be very important to define if these patients, how will behave these patients. My personal feeling is, and it is shared with other colleagues, is that some of the tumors in the past called alveolar and lacking the translocation were tumors like these. And this is a tumor that shows microalveolar pattern and sclerosis. But this is now classified as a spindle cell sclerosing rhabdomyosarcoma. And this is the category recognized by WHO. And this tumor is a mutation of MYOD1. And according to very preliminary studies, these tumors look like behaving more aggressively. So this future protocol will be very important also to see how these spindle sclerosing behave. So many questions are still open, and moving to the last group of solid tumors in the WHO classification. These other solid tumors include neuroblastomas, nephroblastoma, hepatoblastoma, and so on, are all blastomas. So their classification is based on the developmental approach and on the concept that these tumors reproduce the morphological characteristics of the tissue of the corresponding embryonal tissue of origin. This is the classification. You can see that most of them have just the name and the, but this doesn't mean that there are no molecular alterations, because in many of these histotypes, molecular alterations in terms of mutation or other alteration are important in terms of clinical stratification and prognosis. But we don't have time to go through, but we have now a question. How much it is important to obtain such granular data? And I think that the answer stays in this recent paper published by the Central Brain Tumor Registry of the United States. In this study, they have stratified the patients. This is a tumor registry, and they have enrolled the cases according to the ICDO code, that is a code identifying also the molecular characteristics of these tumors, and it is in the WHO. And for adult tumors in CNS, they were very good to define the epidemiology of the different subtypes according to the molecular features. For pediatric tumors, due to their rarity, the system, these are very preliminary studies, and they collected just for the subgroup of medulloblastoma, SHH activated, and TP53 wild type. And they highlighted how the incidence was 0.03 cases for 100,000 across all the ages, and the median age diagnosis was 20 years old, and there was a male predominance. But they were not able to give more information about the other subtypes because the stratification included two different codes. But in the next protocol, the extension of codes with the integration of a molecular feature will make it much easier. And also the inclusion of, it is hopeful that the expansion of studies in the different countries may give a more complete landscape for not only for brain tumors, but also for other tumors. And the true answer why it is important, I think, is in this question: why do young people get cancer? And in this nice overview, Kensis says that the framework that studying the exposure has implication not only for research, but also because it is the basis to define strategic therapeutic approaches. And it is now known that the pediatric tumors are mostly related to the interaction of these three factors: the constitutional predisposition, oncogenic pathogens and exposure, and developmental mutators. And it is interesting how these factors can interact. And it is also very interesting to see how some fusions are often accompanied by specific alterations involving the DNA transposases, dysregulation, and activation, which are involved in the disruptive events that can lead to fusions. This has been studied in leukemia with the role of RAG1-2, but also in solid tumor with the role of PGBD5. But this is beyond of my expertise, and I just want to show the example of germline SMARCB1 mutation in rhabdoid tumor and how in these tumors, at least in one third of these tumors, there is also the PDGBD5-induced somatic mutation, and this demonstrated how all different factors can be integrated in and give the final catastrophic results of a tumor, of a malignancy. In conclusion, probably it is very difficult we will get the same success as in adult cancer because of the rarity of these tumors. But for sure, the epigenetic and the molecular the epigenetic studies and many other analyses we are carrying will contribute to this granularity in classification, and the integration of diagnosis will be able to define new markers of tumor aggressivity and tailored approaches to the therapy. An example is already present for patients affected by DNA mismatch repairs, in which PARP inhibitors work better, but there will be, hopefully, more examples. And there is also the better understanding of pathogenetic mechanism. It's hopeful that will act also in prevention of tumors with analysis of predisposing factors. And this is the hope we have. Thank you.
Well, dear Rita, thank you very much for such a comprehensive overview. Whenever I think I'm updated that I learned something new, I realize that we need to learn so much more. And do we have any questions? Not in the chat. Does anyone want to ask directly? Please do not be shy.
And the subject is not exactly epidemiological.
Well, in a way it is, because you very nicely put the diversity of diagnostics and development of cancer into one umbrella, and importance to have the precise diagnostics so we can have the target therapy. And I think one of the best examples recently was the lanotrectinib, which was registered, as I remember, as the first histologically independent drug. And its story is so interesting that affecting the NTRK mutations, we just put the tumors that we will previously never put in the same categorization. Now we realize that they fit there and they can successfully be targeted like that.
Actually, I would like to say one thing. You touched one of the major points, that is the agnostic approach. And the agnostic approach is exactly the opposite of trying to be granular. Because all these targeted therapies in pediatric tumors are mostly based on this agnostic approach, based only on the identification, for example, of NTRK alteration. But we have not to stop to try to be agnostic, because this is the way we can create the subgroups and understand not only the simple fusion that it can be a driver, but can be also just an incidental finding, but we can understand the mechanism that cause that alterations. For example, I didn't talk about the importance and the seminal studies done by the group of Heidelberg concerning the mutational signature in pediatric tumors. And I suggest if you have a chance to read the beautiful paper, we have to learn a lot on from the mutational signature of tumors and in children, because in adults we this led to the identification of different categories on exposure and so on. But for sure, there is much to do in children where unusual and unexplained mutational signatures have been reported.
And something that it seems that occurs more frequently than in previous years, that we now have duplex tumors in children that was previously, let's say, was seen in adults, and how we can approach to that to the children that you diagnosed two completely, or not that completely, but definitely two different tumor types. So it's also very challenging from therapeutical point of view.
I agree. For example, one of the challenges is to try to make an appropriate treatment, selecting those patients that in theory might be candidate to a second tumor. And so identifying potential genetic polymorphism. I'm not a geneticist, so I'm just trying to imagine, identifying something that can help to see which patient can develop, apart from those with that tumor predisposing syndrome, but patients that have other alterations that can more easily predispose to a second tumor, it could be important, because we see a lot of them and there are some patients that don't have predisposing syndromes. Why there is a subset developing a second tumor and another one not?
Yeah, and we had the patient that you helped us a lot, who was, as you said, just negative from genetical point of view and from peripheral blood, but had two very malignant tumors in the same time, and we could not find, let's say, the causative moment, but there is definitely something, and we need to join our forces, the biologists, the geneticists, the pathologists, the oncologists, and all together to have a systematic approach to the childhood cancer in general, and especially in these very, very challenging cases.
Yeah.